in the service of the King. 216, let's go over to Dwelling in Beulah Land. Let's all stand together as we sing. Far away the noise of strife upon my ear is falling. On that first together. Far away the noise of strife upon my ear is falling. Then I know the sins of earth beset on every hand. Doubt and fear and things of earth in vain to me are falling. None of these shall move me from Beulah Land. I'm living on the mountain underneath the cloudless sky. Praise God, I'm drinking on the fountain. Bountiful supply, for I am dwelling in Beulah Land. Far below the storms of doubt upon the world is beating. Sons of men in battle, the enemy withstand. Safe am I within the castle of God's word entreating.
Singing tonight, and Pastor Garrick, were you keeping up with everybody there? That's, you remind me of me in Mexico trying to sing when they're all at Pastor Sosa's church this last summer, and they're all singing in Spanish, and you're trying to keep up with that, and trying to figure out what they're saying in English. And tell you what, it's a job, but it's great. Good to see you here tonight. What a good service this morning, and enjoyed it very much. If you miss that, you miss something. And looking forward to now what God has in store for us tonight, and looking forward to what God's going to do in each one of our hearts as we hear Brother Hector preach to us this evening, all right? Let's bow together in prayer, shall we? Father, thank you for the opportunity that we have again to gather together here tonight. Thank you for each one who's made their way back to the service this evening. And Lord, thank you for your goodness to us, and Lord, how wonderful you are to us, and you're such a wonderful, good God that does good things in our lives. Thank you for this morning. Thank you for meeting with us and for speaking to our hearts and for decisions that were made for you today. And yet, Lord, we're back this evening because we are a needy people and we need our God to meet with us tonight. Give us what each one of us needs to have as we gather here together tonight, and then as we prepare to leave this place to go back out into the world, that we could honor you. And others would see Christ in our life this week. And so control this service, and may you be pleased with all that's said and done. And I pray it in Jesus' name, amen. All right, you may be seated.
Well, let's turn over to 333, if you would. 333, I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me, the lily of the valley. Let's sing that first together. I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley, in him alone I see. All I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's my saint. He tells me every care on him to roll. Hallelujah, he's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He all my griefs have taken, and all my sorrows borne. In temptation, he's my strong and mighty tower. I have all for him forsaken, and all my aught of scorn. From my heart, and now he keeps me by his power. Though all the world forsake me, and Satan death be sore, through Jesus I shall safely reach. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
All right, a few announcements for us now. Ladies, remember, life's a journey. Just passing through Ladies Retreat down at Heritage Baptist Church in Canal Winchester is Friday, October 14th, Saturday, October 15th. It's $25 for adults, $20 for teens, and that registration and money needs to be in by Wednesday, all right? So you get that money and registration to Lindy McKeon, and she'll see to it that it gets down there by the deadline to get in for the registration. So that's the 14th and 15th, but that has to be in by Wednesday evening to Lindy McKeon, all right? Then remember, Tuesday is the Lunch and Learn Conference presented by 1040 and Brother Moreland, and going to be a great day here, 9 to 3. Parking will be an issue. Okay, they are leaving us some spaces, but as you know, they're very busy over here, and they are using, if you haven't been here during the week at all, they're using quite a bit of our parking lot. And by the way, that's okay. They take very good care of us. We've never paid for snow removal. They pay for it all. Last time the lot got paved and striped, they paved and striped everything and didn't send us a bill at all. They've been very good to us. So if they want to use our park and play during the week, that's usually okay. They are going to leave us an extra row, and the row right up near the fellowship hall and the row right below that. Some of us who can, if I don't know if the back will be open, they're going to begin to park some semi-trailers back there where some of us park on Sunday, so that may not be available. But if you're able to, and we can park over in the shopping area over here and just walk over, then we can do that, okay? And we'll do that just and leave this for maybe some of the guests that will be coming. We have several out-of-town preachers that are coming. The way I figured it, we'll have about 16 parking places to use, okay? So we can certainly fill those up. So if we could save some of those for out-of-town guests, and we'll do the walking, that'll be all right, okay? So that'll be Tuesday. Just make a note of that. So that'll start right at 9. Then there's a lunch, and it goes till 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And, of course, Pastor Garrick will be speaking that morning. Steve Trowell from Restricted Access Country will be speaking about Muslims and witnessing to Muslims. Tim Cleghorn, our missionary, will be speaking as well, again, in a restricted access country, but they're home right now, and so we'll get to see Brother Cleghorn and listen to him on Tuesday as well. So Tuesday from 9 to 3, that's going to be a great, great time. Okay, and then remember the bonfire. Well, of course, Wednesday night service here at 7. That won't be the bonfire. That'll be the Wednesday night service, okay? And hopefully we'll be on fire, amen? And we'll be doing that Wednesday night at 7. And then, of course, Friday night with RU right here. And then Saturday for our soul winning visitation, usual at 10 o'clock. And Saturday evening is the bonfire and the hayride out at Manning's Farm. Bus will leave here right at 4:15 sharp, okay? So be here a little early, make sure the bus is loaded and ready to go, and we'll have a great time there on Saturday evening. Okay. I think that's it. So let's take a minute. We'll welcome any guests with us tonight. Anybody here tonight for the very first time? Looking around, don't see anybody. First time in a long time for Rob Beach, but good to see Rob here tonight. Glad he's here. All right, let's take a minute. We'll hear from the choir.
Psalm 37:337, when we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. Trust and obey. 337 on that first all together. When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Ladies, would you sing that third together? Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share on that third. Not a burden we bear, thank you. trust and obey. Amen. Let's sing that fourth. But we never can prove the delights of His love until all on the altar we lay. For the favor He shows and the joy He bestows are for them who will trust and obey. All together now, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. On that last, all together, and in fellowship sweet, we will sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
All right, we have an anniversary to celebrate. Bill and Lindy McKeon. There we go. September the 19th. Is David going to take your picture? There you go. All right. September 19th for Bill and Lindy. And what a great addition to the church these folks have been. And they do a lot of things that you don't see. Bill drives the bus every week. And just does a great job. And when oftentimes on Wednesdays and RU Fridays, and other times Lindy drives the white bus. And by the way, those of you who might want to get involved with something, I'm going to need a driver for that little, for the white bus. You don't need a CDL or anything. You just need to be able to drive. And if you're interested in that, we could use your help. Okay, and so you see me after the service if you'd like to help with that, and maybe that's a place you can get plugged in, and you can help pick up adults for Sunday school and church, and maybe Wednesday evenings and such, whatever works out with your schedule, but we could use your help, all right? But McKeon's do the RU Kids Club on Friday night, take care of the children that those who come to RU do a great job with that. They're just, they've been a great, great addition to Bible Baptist Church that the Lord sent our way. And they celebrate an anniversary on Monday the 19th. Is that right? And so we're going to celebrate them tonight. We have a card for you, Brother Bill, and flowers for your wife. There we go. All right. Let's sing Happy Anniversary. Congratulations. That's great. All right. Everyone take a songbook again. We're going to sing together. Number 539, All That Thrills My Soul Is Jesus. Number 539. Let's all stand together and sing. Brother Bob will lead us.
Who can cheer the heart like Jesus by His presence all divine? True and tender, pure and precious. Deepest sea. and in my blessed Lord I see. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing the last stanzas together. Sing that last together by the crystal flowing river with the ransomed I will sing. When we get to the chorus, we'll have the instruments drop out on that last together. By the crystal flowing river with the ransomed I will sing, and forever and forever praise and glorify the King.
Good singing tonight. The ushers are coming. They'll receive our offering now this evening. Be prepared to give as God has blessed and prospered you. And Brother Moreland just talked to me there during the break. And those of you involved in Grove City School of the Bible on Tuesday evening, they'll cancel those classes for this Tuesday. Brother Yoder, Brother Hem, they'll be here all day for the meeting, and they'll be doing some things with Pastor Garrick in the evening. So it'd be best if we postpone those classes, all right? So you'll pick it up again a week from Tuesday, all right? That'll be October 4th, I think it is. So just make a note of that. If someone's not here that's in those classes, would you pass it along to them? No School of the Bible on Tuesday night, okay? All right, let's pray and we'll ask God's blessing on our giving this evening. Father, we thank you for the privilege it's ours to give, and thank you, Lord, for your goodness to us and how you take care of us. And we pray your blessing on our offering tonight. And Lord, I pray you'd accept the tithe, the offering that is given this evening. You would use it to take care of the needs of the work here in this place. Lord, we desire to get the gospel to the ends of the earth. And I pray, Lord, you continue to enable us to do that. Thank you for the faithfulness and the generosity of the people of this place, Lord, and their heart for you and giving. And I pray that you'll bless this offering tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. In 2010, we took our first missions trip to Mexico with Bearing Precious Seed out of El Paso, and took a bus down there from Milford. They loaned us a couple guys to drive, and I think was it the first year the Taylor brothers? Well, it might have been Phil and Paul Taylor that drove us out there, and what a time that was. And had a great time on the Greyhound bus, and it was a great time. But that's the first time I met this fellow named Hector Jimenez, and what a servant of the Lord that he is. And that was before I had my hips replaced. I had arthritis very bad in my hips, had a hard time walking and getting around, but he was so gracious and always so helpful. And just the thing that you notice if you just step back and watch is how much he was a servant to whatever needed to be done. And not only is he a great preacher, he has a lot of good contacts. He's grown up in the area there, and he's the one who negotiates with some of the authorities in Mexico and getting permits and different things for the buses. And he's the man. He's highly respected there, has a good testimony there. But he's a great preacher as well. And to gather those folks together, you just have to almost see it to believe it can happen. And he not only can minister to the little ones, the little children, but then when they get to the side, he calls the adults up and he gives the gospel to the adults. And as I said this morning, literally thousands saved every summer. And he's been doing that since 2000. So 16 years, 17 years worth of summers. You add up those numbers, that's a lot of people that are going to be in the heaven because of Hector Jimenez. And so I've been wanting to have him come, and they come back for the Milford Mission Conference, which just ended this past, what day is today? Sunday? This ended Thursday night there. And so I wanted him to come and be in our church, and it worked out well for them to come and have this Sunday open. So we're delighted that they're here. Tanya Reed's going to come and sing for us, And of course, Tanya, as you know, with her dad, worked down there at BPS for many years, and they know the Jimenez real well. And she's going to sing a song, I think, especially for him, and she may say a few words about that. All right, so she'll sing. Then, Brother Hector, when she's done, you come and preach for us. Tanya?
I'm going to sing about a servant's heart. And one thing that you see with Brother Hector is his servant's heart and his wife's servant's heart. I've seen them go through several different directors down there, and each one, whatever they can do to serve them. And so I'm thinking of Brother Hector and Miss Ophelia as I sing Servant's Heart.
Make me a servant like you, dear Lord, living for others each day. Humble and meek, helping the weak, loving in all that I say. Give me, Lord, a servant's heart. Here's my life, take every part. Give me, Lord, a servant's heart. Help me draw so close to you, let your love come shining through. Give me, Lord, a servant's heart. Give me, Lord, a servant's heart. Make me a witness like you, dear Lord, showing the love of the sharing your word till all have heard, serving whatever the cost. Give me, Lord, a servant's heart. Here's my life, take every part. Give me, Lord, a servant's heart. Help me draw so close to you, that your love comes shining through. Give me, Lord, a servant's heart. Give me, Lord, a servant's heart.
Okay, I think we are. All right. Well, it's obviously a privilege, and it's a blessing to be here with you guys. Thank you for the hospitality, Pastor. Thank you for your love and sharing with us, you know, the nice apartment there, beautiful, separated and beautiful. I met the pastor, your pastor, in that trip to Mexico, and I noticed that you know, his love for the souls is authentic, and he's always, I understand you support 63 missionaries. So praise the Lord for that. We always, you know, when I was little, I had the idea that good and evil were two equally opposed forces. But then, as I grew up, I realized that nothing that is created is equally empowered than that God. In other words, Jesus was not created. The Holy Spirit was not created. The devil was created. So therefore, he's not an equally opposed force to the, you know, the power of God. When we rebel against power, it is not as bad as when we rebel against authority. There's one unpardonable sin, and it's the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. Is it okay? Can you hear me now? All right. So there's one unpardonable sin, and it's the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. And like my brother said, you know, I have my own version of English, so bear with me. It's not an accurate, it's not an updated one. But that's the only unpardonable sin, rebelling against authority. God has the authority. The devil doesn't have the authority. We're going to go to some passage of the scripture. If you go with me to the book of Matthew, chapter 16, I'm very nervous. Matthew chapter 16. And we're going to start reading in verse 13. It says there, I believe you guys stand when you read God's word. So if you want to do that, if I say something different to what the pastor says, you know, I'm wrong. He is right, okay? He is right, okay? All right. Chapter 16 and verse 13, he says, when Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they say, some say that thou art John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. He said unto them, but whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for this day. Lord, thank you for this time. Lord, thank you for your precious word. Lord, thank you for your Holy Spirit, Lord. Lord, just be with this earthly vessel, Lord. Allow me, Lord, to give the message, Lord, that I believe you gave me, Lord. Allow me to say the things that you wanted me to say, Lord, and ordain my thoughts, Lord. Help me, Lord. I need you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, you may be seated. All right, this is, a question, you know, that a lot of times we come to this passage of Scripture and tell you the truth. You know, I read it so many times. I listened to my MP3 many times, the same passage. And I never thought about, what all the meaning that it has, what really entitled. And but I was, if you go with me, we're going to read some passages of Scripture, but let's go to Luke chapter 23. I'm going to try to, give you a few points on that question that the Lord has asked. Luke chapter 23. In verse 39. Luke chapter 23 and verse 39. We're going to read again. It says there, and one of the malefactors which were hanged railed on him, saying, if thou be the Christ, save thyself and us. But the other answering rebuked him, saying, dost now thou fear God, seeing that thou art in the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds, but this man had done nothing amiss. And he said unto Jesus, Lord, remember me when thou comest in thy kingdom. And Jesus said unto him, Verily I said unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. And we over here again, you know, this story, I read it so many times, and I listened to this story so many times, but I never thought, you know, but one of the things that always amazed me was that declaration of the thief. Both of them made a declaration from what it was in their hearts. Both of them. I start to think, and I like to imagine one of the thieves, you know, the guy that was mocking the Lord. You know, there's no doubt that he had previous knowledge of what the Lord, what he has done, what he knew about the Lord. Because otherwise he wouldn't ask him, you know, if thou art the Christ. And that declaration there, you know, a lot of times we tend to believe that Jesus Christ is the name of our Lord, but in reality his name is Jesus, and he is the Christ, which means the Messiah, the one that was the Savior of the world. That's what the word Christ means, Messiah. It's a different, you know, meaning in Greek and in Hebrew, but it's Messiah, the one that was promised, the one that was to deliver us from our sin. So when he declared that, when he says those words, he says, if thou art the Christ, there's no doubt that this guy knew about Jesus. There's no doubt that he had listened about what he has done, and probably both of those guys were in jail, awaiting for their time, you know, to be crucified. That was the way that they were executed back then. So he was there in the jail, and he was, you know, listening about Jesus, and he was, you know, that this guy, you know, that he's healing people going through the villages and healing people and making the lame to walk again, and making the dumb to speak, and some of the people even he brought back to life. They were waiting there, both in prison, but this other guy, you know, he was thinking and realizing. He said, probably, if I would have known him earlier in my life, I won't be in this condition. I won't be here in prison. But both of them knew about the Lord. Both of them knew what he has done. Every one of them knew who he was. The guy declared, if thou art the Christ. There's no doubt that this guy was doubting everything that he said. You know, the Bible describes the story of the crucifixion, and they were there. And these words that are recorded here that we're reading from are on the last minutes before Jesus died. So this guy, you know, hanging in the cross, he was there, and he says, you know, this guy, all what they have said about him is not true. All this time, you know, hanging in the cross, all this time they're suffering the same way that we are suffering, and he hasn't done anything. If he's really God, if he's really the Messiah, if he's really the one that was to deliver the people of Israel, why is he here with me here dying? Why is he here? So the words that he declares, they really encompass everything, all of the disbelief of this guy's heart, all the hatred, all of the blackness of that life, you know, living to please himself. That's the declaration of this guy. He says, if thou art the Messiah, if thou art the promised one, you know, take us out of the, deliver us from here, from this situation. Deliver yourself first and then deliver us. And then the other guy, you know, listen to the words. Listen to the declaration that he, those short statements that he did, you know. I mean, he was the most, I really believe that this guy was the most, eloquent guy, you know, the most, one of the, you know, the most concise, the most, well, you know, the all of the, what when his declaration, he says in verse 42. And this message is really simple. I'm not going to keep you long. You know, it's really simple, but I really want to challenge us by the end on the message. It says here in verse 42, he says, and he said unto Jesus, this is the words that he told him. He says, Lord. That simple statement, that declare, you know, that he realized who he was talking to. Said, maybe this is late for me at this time in my life. I'm about to die. But I know who you are. I know that you are the Lord. I know that you are the Messiah. I know that you are the promised one. Why am I saying this? Because look what he says on the next few words that he says. It says, remember me. Remember me when thou comest in thy kingdom. With those short few statements, he was saying, you know, I know that you're the Messiah. I know that you're the promised one. I know that you're the one that can deliver me, even in this condemnation right now. This is not the last stage of my life. This is not the last minute. I know that you're going to come back in your kingdom because you're the king of this world. I know that you're going to come back again. This is not also the last time that I'm going to see you, Lord. Even we are here condemned, crucified, and you haven't done anything because I know who you are. You are the Messiah. You are the one that is going to deliver me of this condemnation. It was sad that he didn't have any time to know the Lord on the public streets, but he met the Lord before the crucifixion. He knew about the Lord. He knew who he was. He knew, but imagine, you know, being there and then all of a sudden they bring these guys to be crucified, and the one that he was always suspecting, the one that he was always knew, that he knew that he was the Savior of the world, right next to him. They were both exposed to the same situation, but one of them declared what was in his heart, and the other one declared what it was in his heart. And I always amazed, there was a teacher in college. This guy was a mathematician. And this guy was a young teacher, you know, one of the youngest teachers that I ever had at college years. And we admire him. Because he knew mathematics. I mean, he spoke mathematics all the time. And this guy, you know, I don't know how many people here is, you know, that engineers or up to that level, I don't know who. But this guy was able to make all the transition from the classic mechanic, in other words, Newton's mechanics, you know, the laws of mechanics, to the quantum mechanics. So he had books and books of notebooks and notebooks. I mean, he showed us those notebooks about all the calculations that he had done. I admire him. Every time that I was in front of him, same thing happened when I first met my wife, you know, well, my wife-to-be. I wanted to say, nothing come out of my mouth, you know. So the same thing with this teacher. You always wanted to be able to ask an intelligent question, you know. You wanted to, you know, really see what, you know, what he can share with you. And I think it was for this guy, you know, to be able to tell the Lord in those short statements, tell him, you know, I know who you are. I know, Lord, that you're the one, the Messiah, the promised one. You are the one that is going to deliver this system of things, you know, now. And he say, remember me also, you know. I know that you're not going to, this is not the end for you. It's not the end for me also. Remember me. And I know you are the King of kings, the Lord of lords, when you come in thy kingdom. That that day, you know, and the answer of the Lord, he says, you know, verily, verily, I said unto you, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. Amen. That was, you know, the proper answer for the expectation of this guy, the highest expectation of this guy. And going back to our passage, you know, and mentioning again about the two forces in the world, you know, that are opposite but not in equal power, because the power of the devil will never compare to the authority of God. Same situation with, you know, a lot of times our experience on salvation. And before we go finally to the last part, I'm going to ask you to go with me to the book of Acts, chapter 9. And we're going to see another example, Acts chapter 9. In starting on verse 5, we know the story when Saul was persecuting the church, and he was asking letters from the principals and the Pharisees to go to the villages and drag the Christian people and bring them out of, and expose them publicly and kill them. And he was doing that, believing that what he was doing was right. But this is when the Lord, you know, finally got a hold of his heart. In verse number 5, he says, and he says, "Who art thou, Lord?" And the Lord said, "I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks." A lot of times, you know, I was trying to understand why, what was the meaning of that, you know, kicking against the pricks. And when he was persecuting the church, I believe that a lot of times the Lord manifested himself through the situation that he experienced. When he, when, you know, when the Bible says that he was there when they stoned Stephen, he was there, he was present, and they stoned Stephen, and Stephen, instead of start cursing, start feeling, you know, making, getting mad, he was joyful. He says, even he said, you know, "Lord, don't take this sin in consideration. Don't." That's what he said. So when the Bible, I believe that when he says, you know, that you're kicking against the pricks, I think that the Lord was already talking to his heart. I think that he knew what he was doing, that he was going against God. You know, he was going against the Lord. And then he says, and he trembling and astonished said, "Lord," again, you know, realizing, recognizing who he was. He said, "Lord," the Lord had to explain the situation to him in a few words. He said, "You are, what you're doing is not the right thing. You have a zeal to serve the Lord, but it's not the right way you're doing it." And that, then he realized that was enough for him to realize. He said, "Lord, what will thou have me to do?" And that is the question, you know, that we as a Christian we should have, you know, the same situation. In other words, you know, that going back to our passage, a lot of people was following Jesus all the time. We know that. The 10 lepers, you know, that they were outcast and declare, you know, they say, "Lord, have compassion upon us." And the Lord had compassion. He told him, "Go and show thyself to the priest." And on their way, they all got healed of their leprosy. But not all of them got saved. Just one came back and said, "Thank you, Lord, for healing my leprosy." And he was the one that got saved. There was always a lot of people that was following Jesus. Always, everywhere, you know, people that got fed and they were following Jesus because of that reason. They say, "Well, you know, we have a good time with this guy. You know, he speaks nice things, and the main thing is the, you know, the fellowship. You know, I think all this were Baptists, no, brother. So, you know, they were. Everybody's is looking for Jesus for a particular reason. That's why the Lord, you know, asked the disciples that time. He says, "Who does the people say that I am?" And that's the same question that is applicable now to our churches, to our beliefs. You know, is somebody say that in a plastic society, no, the all of the commitments, all of the relationships are also not so strong. It's just a plastic society that we're living. Plastic relationships. And it used to be that wooden ships will take men of iron to the mission field. And now ships of steel take men of wood to the foreign field, mission field. So it's sad. But it's the same decision that we are faced, you know, facing every day in our lives. The Lord is telling every member of the church, who do you think I am? Who do you think I am? There, you know, there was a little kid when I was in grade school. This guy, you know, he was, after a while, he was known for, he was a little, you know, how do you say, you know, he was always hungry. And after a while, people knew who he was. One time, you know, there was a kid that had said, you know, my sandwich disappeared. I don't know where it's at. And they were looking for the sandwich, you know, all over the place. They couldn't find it, you know. But then they went to this kid and they asked him, you know, they say, well, get up. And the little kid got up and he was sitting on that sandwich, you know. He had it put back there. So they knew this kid, you know, that he was always hungry for some reason. And one time, you know, this is a thing that I don't forget. Crayons disappeared and they couldn't find the crayons. Crayons anywhere, you know. There was a kid that looking for his crayons, and they asked everybody, and they went to the kid, and they said, "Do you have the crayons?" And the kid said, "No, I don't have them." And all of his teeth, you know, they were like a one color short of a rainbow, you know. So, it won't take long to realize who he was. For the things that he did. And the Lord is interested now, and he's asking the question, who do you think I am? Because the man has a different opinion of who he is. What is the reason that you come to the Lord? It is always the opposite. And a lot of people really struggle with that. But if I can give you, three thoughts, you know, on why are you here? You know, why do you come to church? Who do you think personally the Lord Jesus is in your life? A lot of times we say, you know, well, you know, the Lord is my Savior. But does our lives really prove who He is? You know, our family comes to church every time that the doors of the church are open. Because the devil doesn't have any problem when the people believe in God. He doesn't have any problem with that. The Bible says that even the demons believe in God and they tremble. The devil has problems when you and I believe what God says. That's when the devil has a problem. When you and I really believe what he says. Who do you think Jesus is? And this is revealed every day. You know, a lot of times we say, well, Jesus is our provider. But we struggle giving our tithes. Is he really the provider? He wants to really know who do you think he is in your life, your personal relationship with God. Is he the one that guides you? How often do we read our Bibles? Is he the rock of your, you know, refuge? How often do we pray to him? Who do you say Jesus is in your life? Not just by your words, but by your, you know, really daily living. When we are confronted with that, you know, it's always the dilemma, say, you may say, and the world will tell you, the world will tell you. Seeing is believing. While Jesus is telling you, believe so that you can see. He's telling you, give and it shall be given unto you. Who do you say Jesus is in your life? He says, die to self and you will live. Who do you really say that Jesus is in your life? Let's bow our head. Hanson. Pretty sure.
With our heads bowed and eyes closed as we wait on the Lord here for a minute this evening. Who is Jesus in your life? Years ago, I heard somebody say, you only really believe that which motivates you to action. We talked this morning in Sunday school, remember in 1 John, he that saith compared to him that doeth, or he that walks, our talk and our walk. Does your walk show you know who Jesus is? Does your walk show that he is the Lord? That he is the anointed one? That he is the Messiah? That he is the Savior from your sins? I wonder how many believers tonight would say, Pastor, the Spirit of God spoke to my heart tonight through the message. Pray for me this evening. Would you slip your hand up now? Yes. Yes. Amen. You may put them down. I'm going to pray. We'll have our invitation. Time for you to respond to what the Lord has spoken to your heart about. And you do what God's bidding you to do. Father, thank you for the message here this evening. Thank you for Jesus. And Jesus, thank you for what you have done for us and for who you are. Help us to have the right view of you. Help us to not get distorted in our view of who you are. Lord, we don't want the view the world would say you are, others would say you are. We want the view of what God's word says you are. And Lord, thank you for speaking to hearts tonight. May each one do what you're bidding them to do in their heart. May holy decisions be made for you this evening. And I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Brother Bob's going to sing an invitation hymn. God has spoken to your heart. Respond to him this evening. Will you please?
Search me, O God, and know my heart today. Try me, O Savior. Know my thoughts, I pray. See if there be some wicked way in me. Cleanse me from every sin and sin. sin. Fulfill thy word and make me pure within. Fill me with fire where once I burned with shame. Grant my desire to magnify thy name. Lord, take my life and make it wholly thine. Fill my poor heart with thy great love divine. Take all my will, my passion, self, and pride. I now surrender, Lord, in me abide.
Look this way for a minute, if you would. You know, Hector, it always amazed me, the thief on the cross. The faith he had. Do you remember what Isaiah said about Jesus when he was on the cross? He said his visage was so marred, so mangled, you could not even tell he was a human being. And as that thief looked over at what he thought was a man, he said, Jesus, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Well, that you talk about faith, to believe that he was God, and yet that's what he looked like, that's what he was suffering, and that's great faith. We believe, we talked about tonight in our 5:30 class, you know, we believe in somebody we've never seen. I don't care who you are tonight, you haven't seen God. We by faith believe in him. You haven't seen Jesus either. But we by faith believe in him. One day it won't be faith, it'll be sight. But he saw. But boy, he didn't see what we would expect to see. You know, sometimes you see these paintings in art galleries and there's Jesus with a little crown of thorns and a trickle of blood coming down his face. That's not even close to what it was really like. What faith it took for him to say, you're the Lord. You have a kingdom, and I'm going to trust in you. And wow. When we get to heaven, we're going to step back, and there's going to be a lot of folks going ahead of us who had great faith. And we're just going to be in awe at some of the people like that. Great thought-provoking message. And thank you for that, Brother Hector. Thank you. And just a blessing to have you here. Thank you for your service for the Lord. And great, a good man and a wonderful family. Yes. Said his wife and the children. Now you have how many older children? Three older children? You have three older children. You have five altogether, right? Okay. I'm sorry?
Three older boys.
Okay. And they're all serving the Lord as well. You have... I met some of them when I was down there. Amen. Okay, they're in El Paso. Good. Amen. And that's just a great. Just enjoy this family and enjoy this man. Came up from Milford, and Saturday, Brother Bob had to go up north and do some work on a house with his dad, and so Brother Hector and his son went up with him, and they worked all day with him on Saturday, helping. I think you were siding a house or something and doing some other work, just renovation on a house, and just serving. He talked to me the day after lunch, said they're staying, their next service is in Pennsylvania next Sunday, and he wanted to know if there was anything needed done around here that he could do it. So you're just a couple weeks late, we'd had you painting, brother, but that's but that's the kind of people they are. Really is. So you're get a chance to get to know them a little bit and pray for them. Delightful people. And we sure appreciate Hector and his family. All right. Well, let's pray together and then be praying for this week. And how many are going to come out on Tuesday to the meeting with Brother Ron? How many are going to be here? Good. Good. All right. And I got quite a few folks coming from out of town, pastors and missionaries and such. So it should be a wonderful day. If you're not here, and some of you I know have work obligations, will you pray for the day? And put a little alarm on your phone there, a little message reminder that you will pray for us that day, that it'll be a blessed of God. It'll touch the hearts of pastors. Brother Nip is introducing a new ministry, kind of a group that we're trying to get together of pastors that'll unite together with missionaries and be able to take missions trips and connect with missionaries that want pastors to come and help train their people. And then Brother Moreland is developing a curriculum for a Bible Institute and that they're having there in Armenia, Pastor Garrick's church, and then it'll go other places as well, and it'll be exciting. Brother Jarvis isn't here, but he announced publicly, and now we can too, finally, and that they are switching their field to Honduras. They are not with BPS anymore. Of course, it's been 3 years, and they've transitioned the ministry now to Brother Wynn and his family, and so now they are focusing on Honduras. In fact, they'll be heading there, I think, the first week of October, right?
Next week?
Well, that's pretty close, isn't it? Yeah, pretty close. And is that next Saturday or this Saturday? Never mind. And inside joke there, right? But they'll be heading down there, and they'll stay, I think, this time for like a month or so. And they actually will eventually be looking to move there and have a house built on the property there where Adam and his wife are serving. And then they'll, you know, that out of that orphanage there, they've already had 22 churches that have been started. And this is another area where we'll hope to work with them through 1040 International and give these men some Bible training that'll help them to become more effective in pastoring their churches. And other guys who will go out to plant churches will have some Bible training behind them. And this will facilitate that. So he sent me a letter and got a prayer card and such. He had told me personally a while back that this was going to happen, and but we couldn't say anything publicly till they announced it to Milford at the conference last week. And so now he sent me their new prayer card, and we'll get some more of those for you to have. But wanted everybody to know that about Jack and Sherry, okay? And we're excited about that. And you know, here, not many guys who change the mission field at 70. But he said, I'm asking God for 10 productive years down there, is what he said. And knowing Jack Jarvis, he'll get that. And he's a wonderful, wonderful man. And so anyway, wanted to update you on that, all right? Let's bow our heads together, shall we? Father, thank you for a wonderful day today. Thank you for a wonderful time in the house of the Lord today. Thank you for Pastor Garrick and him coming here to be with us. And Lord, for Brother Hector tonight and the message. And Lord, it's just thank you for servants of God, not only in our country, but across the world, that faithfully proclaim your word. Lord, it's just an honor to see your work and to meet your men who do your work in other parts of the world. Thank you for allowing us to have them with us here today. Pray your blessing upon them. We pray your blessing on the meeting on Tuesday. Stir the hearts of the pastors that are here, the missionaries that are here. And Lord, I pray that we'll be passionate about getting the job done for you and getting the gospel to every creature. Now, Father, dismiss us with your care. And Lord, as we leave this place tonight, make us mindful of who you are and help us to honor the Son throughout this week. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. Let's sing it together, shall we? We hear you sing. Hey, it's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. It's a grand thing to follow Jesus anywhere and everywhere I go. For it's a grand thing to be a soldier in his army here below. It's the grandest thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. God bless you. You are dismissed.